Good morning, Nikki. Good morning. As everybody comes in and finds a seat, let's go over a few quick announcements. I'm going to say it's nice to be back after being gone for a couple weeks, so it's nice to see everybody again. And we've got a lot of stuff coming up. I don't even know if everything's on here. Trunk or Treats is coming up towards the end of the month. We are on Chapter 2 of The Way, Truth, and Life that we started last week. Hopefully you have all your stuff again for today. Let's see, trying to run through this real fast. Cody told me I was up and I didn't get to read my notes. Items needed for live nativity. There are still milk jugs, glass jars, old candles, sheets, pillowcases, things like that that are still needed. Please see Elisa Blevins for any of that. Thanksgiving baskets begin today. We will be collecting non-perishable food items for a Thanksgiving meal to bless four families here in our community. Some items needed are potatoes, stuffing mix, vegetables, cranberry sauce, and anything else. English was my hard part. I gotta remember the commas. I gotta slow down and breathe before between commas. Upward basketball, the flyers are out. It's gonna be coming to start here soon. Gentlemen, pay attention. Men's rally in the valley is up next Saturday. Children's benefit dinner is coming up on the 24th. Please see Nancy Gamble for any of that. NYI Fall Retreat. Teens, if you're interested in Fall Retreat, please see me after church today, between church and Sunday school, or church and life groups, I call this. I will have your Fall Retreat forms. The vendor show is coming up, and Operation Christmas Child. So please pay attention to those. Let's go ahead and open in prayer this morning, as it's semi-beautiful day, because it hasn't started raining yet, so we're going to go with that. So, we love it even if it rains, so... Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the glory and the joy of us being together as family, Lord. We pray that you'll just move today in spirit and in life and in love with each of us, Lord. I pray that you'll just bless this sermon as it's presented, bless the community, the other churches in the community, Lord, and bless the families here. I pray that you'll just continue to move in us and allow us to show who Christ is to those that we come in contact in the community. In your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. If we could stand for the reading of God's Word and continue to stand as we praise the Lord. 1 Corinthians 16, verses 13 and 14. Be on your guard. Stand firm in faith. Be courageous and be strong. Do everything in love. You know, sometimes we come across people that if you're not in God's love, it's hard to do those things in love. It's hard to love those that are unlovable. But I am thankful for the grace of God, for the Holy Spirit that lives within us, that we can love everybody. You know, we look a little bit different today, but with Shelly and Jan and so many others being gone, but guess what? The Lord is still here. The Holy Spirit is here today. Amen. So listen, as we sing today, remember and open up your hearts to what the Lord would have for you, because He is here and He is good. Sing with us.
Yeah. Shine, 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 shine blessings he's given us that we have to praise him. I just think about my many blessings. I have, you know, a Savior who died on the cross so that my sins can be forgiven and I can be in relationship with my Heavenly Father. I have my health and my loving husband, and we have a house that gives us shelter. I have all of you here to support me, to support us in our travel, our journey, that, you know, on our way to our Heavenly Father. And I'm just so blessed and thankful for all of that. So many things we have to praise our Father for. Does anybody have a praise from this past week that they just want to give all glory and honor to our Father for?
Yes, I just want to say praise the Lord. This week I went to the doctor's because I've been using my electric wheelchair at home and haven't been able to walk hardly at all. And they give me a cortisone shot in my knee, and I have done 6 loads of laundry this week by myself.
Praise the Lord for that. Can we just
praise the Lord for my family, my son, my daughter, my soon-to-be grandson. I just praise the Lord that we have a home and just that they love me and I love them.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Praise the Lord for my family.
3 years ago, I went back to school and some of the teachers that I talked to said there were some signs of dyslexia. And the era that I grew up, that wasn't just, I don't know if it was discovered or it wasn't pushed or whatever, but I've never been tested for it. Here within the last couple weeks I've been, I was actually tested for it, and well, it did show up that I'm dyslexic, so I went over to Kent Friday, and I'm hoping to go back to school the first week of the year, and now I'll have help with subjects and stuff like that.
All right, it's so great to find out that there's support, so praise the Lord for that. For anybody else with praise.
I just praise the Lord because this week I've been really praying for a long time about my neighbor, and he had a really, really bad diagnosis of cancer, and I didn't know where he was spiritually, if he knew the Lord or anything like that. He's 84 years old. I grew up, he was my neighbor when I was a kid, so he came over to tell me his kind of bad news. He's going Monday. He has cancer on the side of his face, so just lift him up in prayer. But I was able to lead him to the Lord. So that was my day.
Oh, wonderful. Lord, anybody else have a praise?
I'd like to say something. Oh, we got somebody else.
Go ahead, Don.
No, last week Jane and I spent the week in Las Vegas, and we used to live there in the late 90s, but we had never gone to the Caesar's Palace because we didn't gamble. And no, we didn't want gambling while we were there. But we had a great time, but we had never visited the Caesar's Palace there. And we went there for dinner at the Cheesecake Factory. But we walked in there, and it was just a grand building. I mean, it was a grand place. I mean, and we got lost in there trying to get out, trying to get to the Cheesecake Factory. But just the architectural and everything, all of the stuff that was in there, it was just amazing. But it made me realize, and it was a, you know, that's a man-made structure, but it made me realize and made me think that when we cross over to the other side, into the presence of our Heavenly Father, how grand that will truly be. I mean, it will be more than what we could ever think of in our simple minds. But I think it's in the Hebrews, it says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard what the Lord has planned for those that are in Christ Jesus. So I am thankful to be in Christ Jesus and to trust our Heavenly Father and know that we have a grand place that He has in store for each and every one of us. And I'm just thankful for that.
Yes, He gives us a foretaste of heaven here with the people, the things that He blesses us with.
We have so much more to look forward to for that.
Okay, here we go.
I'm thankful for God's love.
Amen.
And for His strength. Because if it weren't for His strength, I wouldn't be here today. One last thing this week that we did. Well, in the last part of last week.
You were content.
pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you now, and we just ask your blessing upon the service. Father, you have laid something on Sue's heart, and we just pray that the message that each and every one of us need to hear is in these words. And I'm sure we can all find something somewhere that we're lacking, or just something to bolster us in a certain area. Father, I lift up all the people who are in mourning. There are so many people that have recently lost loved ones. Help them to understand it's only temporary, as everything on this earth is. Father, reduce the intensity of their grief. Help them to smile during their mourning.
Yes.
Which is never easy to do. But if we keep our focus on you and everybody here who has lost someone, so Father, help us to keep the focus on you, to lighten the heaviness in our hearts. Father, be with this service and be with each and every one of us as we go out and spread the word. And this, Father, I ask in your name. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. So many times, we've always joked about it and said that, children, you may go downstairs. But we've always kind of all jokingly laughed that, you know, when Pastor Jan comes walking towards you, don't make eye contact. Well, that's kind of like what happened to me. I kind of thought I was on my way home, heading to my car, and kind of called me back and asked me if I would step in for him today. And he was going to give me time to pray, all of 5 minutes. So I think I just automatically said yes, because 5 minutes would have never been enough. I would just said, I'm still praying about it. But we are in the book, Way, Truth, Life, and it's discipleship as a journey of grace. And so there's going to be a lot of the main discussion about the grace of God in this book. And, the first scripture that comes to mind is our Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9. For it is grace, you've been saved through faith, not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It's a gift. You know, we have such a gracious God, and he gifts his children. The author of the book, David Busick, he gave definitions in the book. He gave a few. And he gave, one of them was the God's unmerited favor. Another one was God's undeserved love. And he also said, it's almost hard to totally describe it. And I think personally, each one of us could probably say the same thing. It's indescribable. When I know that, and personally, when I share my experience with the Lord and how his grace has overflowed my life, I get to the point where things start flooding my mind and tell, remember this, remember that. God just starts bringing remembrances back from when I was saved, to all the things through our life, to a point in our life where we had come to the Lord when we were in our late 20s, Denny and I, and then we left for about 16 years. We checked out on God for about 16 years. And we came to a service and had been coming here for a while. There was a different pastor here. He was an interim pastor at that time. He came. He was here right before Pastor Jan came. And he preached on grace one day. And it kind of shook my foundation. It just kind of really truly unearthed me. And by the time I got to life groups downstairs, I was in tears. And I remember Miss Arlene Rain sitting there and go, what's wrong?
just got it. It, you know, I came to the Lord by way of crisis. I didn't want to go to hell. I just want to know I was good to go to heaven. But the Lord dealt with me in such a way, and I've gone to a former church that we were raised and our family about, not in, raised about this church. And it had all kinds of rules and regulations and everything, and it just kind of took the joy out of me. That's what separated. That was part of separation. I just was so lost in it. But during that sermon, it was like my life was flashing before me of all the times that God's grace had covered me, covered our kids, covered situations. And Lord knows some of the situations that we had gone through. And I just praise Him for that grace. And, you know, and then when I was started looking at this, I was thinking, you know, there's nothing new under the sun when it comes to the Lord. So His grace was before us, way before us. 2 Timothy tells us that. He has saved us and called us to the holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of His own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. So before we were, you know, a little glimmer in our parents' eye, there was grace to cover us now, today. In the Old Testament, when the Israelites were disobedient, and they were disobedient a lot, Isaiah even tells us, even in their disobedience, he was telling the people, Isaiah 30:18, yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. He longs. He's passionate. And it made me think of some of the other stories, because I thought, well, at our worst or our best, Jesus longs to be gracious to us. And so some of the things that I looked at, we have Noah in Genesis 6 and verse 8. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He was not a perfect man. Abraham and Sarah, we know their story. You know, they kind of lied about saying Sarah was a sister, and she kind of laughed, and, you know, over God saying He was going to bless them with a baby. And yet the Lord came through and made right on His promise. He came through. Moses killed somebody, and God still chose him to set His people free. He used him. Joseph, hated by his brothers, sold into slavery, accused, put into prison, and it was for something he didn't do. And here, God's grace was on him because He was positioning him for something greater. And it was to save His people. And David, after everything that David had done, and there was a lot, right down to fornication, he was, you know, dishonest and had somebody killed, and yet, he was the man after God's own heart. And because of God's grace, God loved him. And then we have Rahab, who was a harlot. And two spies seek shelter, and she bargains for her life and confesses her belief in God to them. And it turns out they show her mercy, and they showed mercy to her and her family. And then she ends up dwelling with the Israelites and faithfully ends up serving the Lord the rest of her days. That's grace. Psalm 103 and verses 8 through 10. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will He harbor His anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. In the first chapter of this book that we're all doing, and I'm sharing this because I know not everybody is reading the book, But the story behind the song Amazing Grace is told. And John Newton, he was a captain of a ship that did slave trade. And he was raised up, his mom taught him. Our book didn't tell me all of this. I did some further research on it to see more of the story. But even his mom had raised him up, teaching him about the Lord. And he still fought and would not believe. And the fact was that he was atheist. And not only was he an atheist, he was sharing that and leading other sailors on the ship to atheism. He was helping them to that they didn't have to believe. And so the fierce storm comes, and it really kind of looks like they're all going to go down. And all of a sudden, and remember I said, I came to the Lord in crisis? So did he. He was in a major crisis. His life was on the line. And he calls out to God. And the Lord, he lives to tell the story. Well, they say that he landed, they find he ended up in Ireland, Donegal, Ireland, and starts reading his Bible. And later on becomes an Anglican, ordained Anglican minister. And then later after that, he writes the hymns to the song Amazing Grace. And what I learned in that was how transforming God's grace can be. Because he received the Lord and started reading his Bible, and it wasn't till years later, I mean, when he did everything to become ordained. But when I read further, it was 6 years he still did the slave trade after he had received the Lord. He was still, some of the things in his life were still not settled. And it said that he, from reading the Bible, he took on a different worldview. And his view towards slavery had changed. And so he quits the slave trade. He mentors another man, and then the man that he, you know, starts to support in his mission happens to be campaigning to abolish slavery. And so that just tells me when God meets up with us, change is inevitable. When God's grace comes into our lives, changes are continuously going to happen, and for the better, which is up to us. I always used to say, I used to say I didn't want a spanking from the Lord, so I really learned quickly that when he would change something in my life, you know, because I don't want to go do that again, because I know what that, you know, all the consequences, because, you know, God's grace comes into our life, but we still go through things. That's part of the growth part of grace, and we go through these things, and we start to get tweaked by the Holy Spirit to draw us in, because the whole idea is we come under God's grace to serve his purpose. It's part of his purpose and his plan. And there was a, he quoted, Busick had quoted in the book, the man's name, I'm sure I will not pronounce him correctly, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And he said, Christianity without living the living Christ is inevitably Christianity without discipleship. And Christianity without discipleship is always Christianity without Christ. Amen. Amen. Without Christ, we have nothing. And following Christ, we have discipleship. We follow him. We grow in him. We never know what the Lord might put in our path and ask us to do. But I guarantee you, he's going to ask us something. He wants to grow us. He wants us to become more Christ-like every day. So grace teaches us, saves us, sanctifies us. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. I used to love saying when we get in family discussions and my sister and I would kind of, and I said, yeah, but I love it when I see that word, all. it doesn't say this group, that person. It says all people. It is offered to all of us. It says it teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. And there's your teacher. There's your teacher. Now, whether we say the no, then that determines how we're going to get to grow. You know, I can start down one path. God has, you know, I used to go my own path. I did my path for 16 years. You know, I didn't do anything bad. I just didn't do anything that pertained to him, or even acted like I knew him, or even lived like I knew him. We just lived a selfish life of our own. And so when the Lord started wooing me back into the path he wanted, well then, obviously, that's what poured out the grace on me. But I was not raised to understand grace. When I came to the Lord, nobody talked to me about the grace of God, nobody. That's how important it truly is, how we communicate our love of Christ to people, and because we want them to come to know the love of Jesus Christ. We want them, we know how full their life can be with him in the helm of it, you know? And nobody did that. And so people kind of, you know, you get lost, you know, where the devil comes in and snatches that right away. I mean, we have to be careful of that. When we have people who are new creatures in Christ Jesus, you got to come up beside them and encourage them and help them along the way whenever we see it, you know? And it says, 2 Peter tells us to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And while, you know, that to me is the Word, you know, that's where our knowledge is going to come of Him, is through His Word. And the more we're in the Word, the more we're going to know Him. And that is just so important. And the more we know Him, the more we grow, because He'll just keep moving us up and teaching us. I read an article, a Reverend Patrick Street, and it's an old article that I was reading, and he wrote this big long article on grace. But there was a couple things that stood out to me that he said. He said, everything that we do outside of God's grace is worthless. It has no power. It's our own power. It's our own. He says, everything good that comes in us and through us is only by the grace of God. Grace saves us, justifies us, sanctifies us, and empowers us for His service. Grace-filled living is exercising the gifts that grace provides and spreads the gospel of grace to a hurting and dying world. He also wrote, God's grace and blessings were not given simply for us to sit in church and feel good. Amen? There's so much more to this walk in our life when it comes to Christ, that if we just think that this is enough to come to church, and it's so much more. It's through fellowship. It's through small groups. It's through life groups. It's through gathering together, and the Lord is the discussion. It just has got to be something. There's always more. There's you know, the world is hurting and it's dying, and I know it is. It's so easy for us to sit here, isn't it? It's so easy to go through the week and show up on Sunday and then go home, have some dinner, and then before we know it, all of those things of our daily life and all those responsibilities will shove itself in front of our relationship with the Lord. It really will. And the Lord is saying, I want to be first. I want to be your focus. The Lord reminds me constantly of how deep His love is for me. And I know how deep His love is for you. Our grace came with a price. It didn't cost us anything. But The price was paid by Jesus Christ dying on the cross for all of us. So we know grace saves, it sanctifies, it empowers, it teaches us, and it transforms us. It transformed Newton. Because when you think about that, it didn't instantly transform him. Once he got into the world, you know, he was being transformed by the world. When he came into his relationship with God, he started searching out the Bible and everything. Then his world, he started changing. It took time. You know, I mean, 6 years. But grace was transforming him, you know. And it said, the other thing that I noted was, grace is not performance-based. We don't have to perform for it. There's nothing we can do except receive it. And why that's such a hard thing for people to do. It was hard for me. It took me a long time. I don't know why, because afterwards I'm like, I was so stupid. You know, because it really is such a simple, simple thing to come into the grace of God. It's just merely talking to Him and pouring yourself out to Him. And like I said, it doesn't mean when we make our mistakes that we won't face consequences. We will face consequences in this journey. Each of us will. That's part of our transformation, becoming like Christ. At the end of the chapter, He gave some questions. And I'm not asking anybody to answer them, but I'm asking you to ponder them this week. It says, when you think of God's extravagant grace, because it's truly indescribable, isn't it? I mean, it really is. But when you think of God's extravagant grace, how does the grace play out in your daily life? You know, if you really tune yourself to God's things in your day, you will see them and you will experience them because they're always around us. God's always with us. So we're the ones kind of get busy and miss out on that. How does grace, what does grace look like when you see it? Because have you not? I have experienced that where I've seen grace in people's lives. Ms. K has the grace of God on her, even through her grief. And so does Ruth. And so does Faye. And so does Donna. And there's so many. That's the grace of God in their lives, carrying them through all of this. And it's empowering. It's empowering them to get up the next day. We get up the next day and keep looking forward because God still has work for you to do. God still has work to be done. It says, what does grace do when we personally experience? Well, only you will know, and only you can describe your personal experience. And I know for myself, it truly is. That's why the song is called Amazing Grace. And it says, what difference does grace make in our everyday life? It's everything. For me, it's everything. Because things come up with, you know, Cody and Nikki. They really need grace poured out right now because, you know, chaos comes. Things happen, you know. From the littlest thing to the greatest thing, God's grace is there for each and every one of us to partake of. I asked Cody to play a song. It's Reckless Love, and it's because it clearly speaks about God's grace. You won't hear all those words of grace and unmerited love. But when you know and feel the love of Christ, that's grace. So we'll listen to the song, and then I will pray and dismiss us.
You breathe your life in me.
Reckless love. That's grace, folks. It's so beyond words. speak of our experiences of it, but I hope that you, if we go back in remembrance, we need to do that once in a while. We need to go back right to that day when we really, really experienced the grace of God and remind ourselves and then stir that up. Because I think since COVID, we've all become kind of relaxed. And I think about, and first words when I was thinking about all of this was Don Rossbach standing up and telling us to get out of our comfort zones. Never were truer words said, because we get comfortable. We get comfortable in our settings. And sometimes you just need to stir that spirit up. Ask the Lord to stir you up. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I just praise you and thank you for this amazing day that you have given us, Lord, and that even right to this very day you have poured your grace out upon us. And your grace has already gone before us, and there's just so many people who have so many needs, Lord, and we know that you're, you know, already aware of them. You already have a plan of attack in mind, and we praise and thank you for that. I pray that Pastor Jan, Shelley, and their family just as having a refreshing, relaxed time away, and that you bring them back safely home when they head back home, and just be with each and every one the remainder of this day until we come back this week, Lord, and we just can't praise you or thank you enough for who you are. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Chapter 2 is for next week, everybody, and go have a wonderful day in the Lord, and life groups are still going on today, and so I hope that if you haven't joined one, there's, you know, something for the kids, something for the teens, something for young adults, something for older adults. We have it covered. So please partake of one of our classes. Bye-bye, everybody.